Good morning, YouTube. In this video, we are going to try and fix Super Mario World. So I recently picked up a copy of this for $10. They usually sell around here for about $30, so I figured, why not? It'll be useful for if I need to sell one of these bundles, which, actually, this is the Nintendo that I had recently fixed up in a previous video. So I go to test it, put it in, we push power, and absolutely no action on the screen at all. Normally, my first instinct is to clean the pins, get out an alcohol swab, try and clean those pins up a bit. They're not in horrible shape. You can kind of see on the video there. This is just to compare what happens with my known working Mario. Works perfectly. Normally, if the pins are an issue, you'll get a black screen and just nothing else, and that's not the case. We're getting absolutely no action, so I think there might be something else at play here. So what we're going to do is open this up, take a look at what the issue could be, and try and resolve that. So to open up Super Mario World, or really any other Super Nintendo console, you need another security bit. It's, again, a game bit screw. So it's round, has these little notches around the side, and it's made to fit in to here. The cartridge screws are a little bit smaller than the ones that hold the console together. So basically just make sure you're getting two of these bits if you're buying two of them. So I'm just gonna unscrew it here and open it up, and I'll show you what we're doing. So to open up a cartridge, there are two screws on the front. All you have to do, unscrew them both, set them aside, and then the cartridge opens up at the top. There's two little clips here at the top which go into place, so they sit into the back of it just like that. So when you go to reclose it, line those up, snap it together, and then you screw the two screws in together. So this is the board. Where's my other screw? There it is. And I keep my screws together on that metallic dish here. So it's magnetic, holds the screws in place so they don't get lost. These are the only cartridge screws in here, so I don't have to worry about mixing them up. So this is the board. So as you can see, the pins are a little bit dirty, but that doesn't look like what the issue is. The issue, I'm just going to get a pin to point it out, I think is going to be right here. You see there's wear marks here, and that may indicate damage traces right here as well. So contact from these pins up to wherever it's supposed to connect onto the chips or any of these other components, I don't think that connection's happening. So what we're going to do is I'm going to get my multimeter and simply test the board for continuity. See if I can get an angle without reflection. There we go. So I have my multimeter, and I set the multimeter to continuity test, which has that little sound symbol on it. And all that does is it checks for a complete circuit. If I touch the tips, I get a beeping sound. So all I have to do now, I go through each pin, one on the bottom, follow these traces to one of the components in here, and touch somewhere there to make sure that it's getting connections. So that works. This pin goes nowhere. This pin goes, I think, off the board to the side here. So there's probably, there's a connection right there. So that one's okay. So I'm just going to go through here for a little bit and try and find some of the pins. I'm going to get a notepad so that as I find the ones that are bad, I'm going to write them down and what I need to fix. Okay, so I have found one pin pretty much right away that's not working properly. And that's going to be pin number 55 right here. So it's difficult to see, but right there it looks like something has worn away at the trace. So I'm not getting continuity from the pin that goes into the cartridge slot up through the remainder of this trace, which goes into this chip here. I've tried replicating that a few ways. So by holding down one of my probes here, touching all the points on this chip, I get no continuity. I get nothing to the battery, nothing to this capacitor, to this resistor, nothing up here. So I think this chip is clearly defective. I'm just going to flip it over as well. So hold it on pin number 55. And on the back side, just to make sure that nothing is going through the board, nothing there, nothing there, nothing there. So I think that's clearly a bad trace. Looks like also some are quite bad here. So this one may be maybe a fair bit of work. So I've done a couple tests on this one. I've tried scraping away a little bit of the green plastic right here to expose the bare metal on the top of that. So if I hold down a probe there, I get continuity. I did the same thing further up the trace right here to expose some of the copper trace, and I touch there and I'm getting nothing. So right here, this trace is broken. Now there's a couple ways to go about fixing that. If you know exactly where the trace terminates, you can run a wire to it. And for that, you just use very small gauge wire like this, used for jumping or soldering boards. Or you can run a jumper, which is essentially a little piece of metal that goes across a small portion and then continues along the original trace. So something kind of like that would sit in place here. I'm going to actually attempt to use a jumper instead of running wire. The reason for that is I'm not 100% positive where pin 55 terminates. If you follow the trace, it goes up and underneath this chip, and it probably distributes to one of these pins. Maybe it goes nowhere, I'm not positive. But without taking this chip off, I can't be certain, and I'm not very interested in desoldering all the chips just to find out. So I'm going to cut this piece of wire to really only be about that long to go over this damaged portion of the trace, and I'm going to hot glue it into place so that it's not going to further deteriorate. So what I've done here is, just using a blade, I've gone and I've scraped away that green plastic covering that's covering the copper on these traces. So I've done the entire thing, and as you can see, there's a pretty clear section where there's no contact between the pin down here and the trace going up the board. So that will obviously need to be jumped. The other reason I've done that is I need a place to put solder into place. I don't want to put a blob of solder down on the pins, because that's what's going to go into the actual console. And I also need an area here of bare metal where I can put solder above the break in order to bridge it. So the very first step is going to be using a Q-tip and some rubbing alcohol. You're just going to clean the area. You don't want any leftover plastic residue, anything else like that, any oxidation, anything that would prevent it from getting a good bond. So clean it, give it a little bit of a buff out to dry, and we are good. So now the tricky part will be soldering in a jumper. So as I mentioned, I have a little piece of metal that I'm going to use for this. And that's, let me grab it here. These things are tough to pick up. So a little piece of metal like this. This was, it's simply a leg from a capacitor that I installed before. I like to hang on to some of those in case I ever need to do something like this. So what you do, get a rough idea of how much you need to about there, and then I'm going to cut that with just wire cutters. Okay, so that is cut. Now, so that's what we have here, and that should be sufficient for size as far as getting that in place. So I'm going to set that aside, and what we're going to do now is lay a little bit of solder on the trace here. So in the interest of full disclosure, this is the first time I've attempted doing this on a game board, so we'll see how this goes. So I got a little blob there. That might be more than I really want, but we'll go back and remove some if needed. And then getting it on this trace will be the tricky part. It doesn't seem to be taking. So I'll try to clean that with some alcohol again and try it again. So I've gone through this board and I've identified a number of traces which are bad. I've found that on the other side, number 55 and number 41 were bad. Pin number 26, 24, 19, 17. I still haven't done these ones. So that's good. That's good. That's good. That's good. That's good. That's good. Good and good. So that's all for traces. So in total, 6 traces needing repair. On the back side is a little nicer because I can actually see where the trace is supposed to go and we can do it appropriately. On the front side, it's a little bit of a different story. So I have 2 options when it comes to repairing these traces. I can, some of them, as you see, they go into these little vias, they're called. And that's basically a hole for the contact to go. So this trace, for example, 26, which I have to repair, it's going to go up through this via. Then on the other side, this is where it comes out. It follows the rest of this trace up to this pin right here. So I could try and repair that trace just going up to this via here with a wire. Or I could run a piece of wire like this, which is flexible, all the way over the board and into the chip that I want. I think I'm going to try and cut down on having excessive wires, so I'm just going to try and run it from here to this via point. So I'm not going to film the whole thing. I'm going to put a little bit of solder here. Try and get some solder in here. I'm not sure how easily it will sit because it's, again, not a lot of surface area, but I'll be back in a couple minutes, show you what it looks like before I put the wire in place. Okay, so I've decided I'm actually going to record this little bit because it's would be worth seeing. So what I've done is I put a small blob of solder here, and I'm going to go into this via. So I've taken another leg from a capacitor, just a thin little piece of wire. I've stuck it in the hole and bent it so that it will stand on its own. And now I'm going to try and solder that into place here. So let's try and do this best I can with providing you with a good view of it. There we go. That should do the trick. So most of what you see there is actually just flux. It's not solder. So I can wipe that away with some alcohol. There, so the reason I did this is it provides, it's not moving. So all you do now, you come in with your wire cutters. I use side cutters, it's just easier to get in there and cut that as close as you can to the board. So the reason I use the piece of wire in the place of the via is to provide a little bit more surface area for the solder to stick, as well as it makes it easier to stick the wire into place here. So I'm going to grab a small piece of wire right here. this wire actually ended up harvesting off an old mod chip for a Sony PlayStation. I grabbed this board that wasn't working properly, and whoever installed the mod chip had done a sloppy solder job. They had lifted up some pads on the board, so it wasn't going to work without a lot of work. And considering PlayStations can be had for $15, depending on where you look, it wasn't worth it to me to try and repair that. Okay, so this is the wire that I'm going to use. So I'm going to connect one end to that post that I've just installed, and the other end into that blob of solder. So all I'm going to do is heat up the existing solder in there, maybe apply a tad more on the post, and line that up. I'm going to trim this piece to fit, so I'll be back once it's installed. Okay, so this is the repair. I haven't tested the continuity yet, but I think it should work. So on the bottom side here, I've got the wire attached to that little blob of solder, and on the top side, I've got the wire attached to that via that I've installed that piece of wire through. So I guess all that's left here to try and do is test continuity. So first, I'm going to test from the bottom of the pin to the via, and we have continuity. So if I flip the board over, this was the one in question that it was coming out of, and was supposed to go, I think, to this pin. I'm not getting anything. So let's follow that trace again. Oh, there we go. And we have continuity. So that's another successful repair. So I'm going to go through and do that for the rest of these, and I'll show you what I've got at the end. Hi, so I'm back. I've gone ahead and fixed all the traces that I found. I'm going to show you quickly what I did, and hopefully you can learn from what I've done and learn from a mistake I made. So, first one we did was number 55. Now, this one's kind of sloppy, but it does work. I had to put a jumper going across the missing trace here. What I had to actually do was cut underneath the trace and lift it up a little bit so I could ball up the copper in that trace in order to get enough surface area for the solder to stick. So I put the trace on the bottom here first, laid it where I need to, and then laid sopper embedding the ball of copper and the piece of wire all at the same time. This one, trace number 41, it actually goes under the board, connects to which one of these? This one right here. So this is a via that goes under between the board and then goes up to the third pin in, I believe. Let's see. Yep, third pin in. So to skip all that, I just soldered directly to the third pin of that chip. The wire comes around, goes to pin number 41. The next one, pin number 17. Again, I took a leg from actually in this case it was an LED. So I have a ton of these. I have about 100 different LEDs. So I just cut the leg off one of them. I stuck it through the via like this. It's tough to see at this angle. And then what I did is I bent it flat against the contact here and trimmed it to fit. Bending it helps keep it in place because you can't hold it while you're soldering. And I just soldered the bottom in place where it needs to be, soldered the top here so it holds it. Then on the flip side, I just cut it off with my side cutters. That's the cutoff bit right there. So that trace is, that trace is complete now. Pin number 24, again, was much like pin number 50, except I had a via to work with instead of just a small trace. So that's the one I showed you how I did. I put the piece of wire through, I cut it off, and then I bridged it. I did this one before I did this one, because once I did this, I figured it would be much easier to just bend it. So you can learn from that one, maybe just bend that bridge. And then pin number 26, I had to run a little wire looping around it. So I'm still going to hot glue all these together so that they don't move and it's never going to move again. But before I do that, I need to make sure that it works. So I'm going to grab my case for the game. and we will install it. I'm not going to screw it up or screw it together because I still need to come back. So unfortunately, some of those blobs of solder do get interfered with, so I may have to trim back the case a little bit. I have a Dremel tool that will do that. But in the meantime, just for testing it, I'm going to take it over to my Super Nintendo. Plug it in. And fingers crossed. Black screen. And we have Super Mario. I'm just going to try hook a controller up and see that it actually works. Okay, so games are empty. I hope that the battery still works. So I'm going to complete a couple levels here and then we will test that. I don't have a battery handy if I need to switch it out, so that may be another video. Okay, so I just completed the yellow switch plate just to test the saving capabilities of that battery that we have here. So I'm going to show you what we do in order to test that. So the way that these consoles work, or the cartridges work, is there's a little bit of storage on the cartridge for some games. It's RAM storage, so it requires a constant little bit of power in order to maintain its save. So if you disconnect the power from it, it's going to lose all its save states. So that's what the purpose of this battery is. The battery here feeds constant power to the RAM chip, and it allows the saved data to remain in there. If you disconnect the battery, you lose all your saved storage. If the battery's dead, you lose your saved games. So what I'm gonna do here is keep it out of the system for about 30 seconds. We're gonna hook it back up and see if it remembered that I just saved the game or not. I'm really hoping that it does, because as I mentioned, I don't have a battery handy to replace it with. I could probably steal one from my trusty John Madden football if needed, but I don't really want to. Okay, moment of truth. And it looks like the battery's okay, so I can pick up right where I left off. So the final step, before I seal it up and sell this, is it's going to be to glue the wires into place on the board, because you don't want these letting go at some point. So to do this, you just use a little bit of hot glue from a glue gun or something. Set it in place so it will set and it won't move. Last thing you want is someone ripping this out of a console, pulling one of the wires out, or trying to clean the contacts with alcohol or Q-tip or something and ripping the wire out of place. So we're just going to glue it right to the board. Hot glue is really the best idea. That way it stays there pretty much permanently. You're going to try and get in close to the pins if you can. The glue does not conduct electricity, so you don't need to worry about bridging any pins or anything like that, because it won't transfer any type of power with it. And then on the other side, we have this one that's going to run around the board. Again, I want to just make it so that there's no stress on any of the solder points. You don't want anything to just eventually wear out or fall off or anything like that. You don't have to encapsulate the entire thing, but as long as you're getting enough so that the wire doesn't move, that's all that you really need. And I'll do a little bit on this bridge here. And a little bit right there. And that's good. So you might notice that it kind of looks a little bit like a spider web here. There's little bits of glue everywhere. So we're just going to clean that up, let them dry a bit, rub them off. We're going to wipe down the pins with alcohol. And before I seal it up again, I'm going to test it in the console just to make sure I didn't disturb anything. If I have to go back and re-solder something, I want to do that before I close it up. And I will grab a Q-tip. So hot glue, it doesn't take too long to dry. I mean, it's not fully set yet, but it's dry enough that I could put the case on it and test it in my console. So I'll do a bit of a wipe here. A good way, I never really fully showed you how to clean a cartridge game. So you take your Q-tip, dump it in alcohol, and you just wipe up the pins. You can, if it's really dirty, you can go up and down pin by pin. I've already cleaned this a couple of times, so it shouldn't be that dirty. But if you turn it over, this one isn't bad, but you might notice it looks a little bit black. So I wipe it with alcohol using the dry end. I dry it out a little bit, check the dry end for more black. If you see black residue, do it again. Keep on cleaning it until it's no longer black. So let's put it in the case. And let's give it a test. So we'll bring it over to my Super Nintendo again. And fingers crossed. And it works. So that is how to repair traces on a Super Nintendo game. It also applies to really any cartridge game, Sega. It appears that you are upside down. I apologize for that. Or maybe, I don't know. Someone's upside down. So, applies to any cartridge game. Yeah, so I hope that this can help someone out there fix some of their old games that they used to love playing. If you have any questions or comments, hit me up in the comments section below. And if you haven't already, be sure to like the video and subscribe to my channel. I'm going to keep uploading new videos as I find things to fix. Thank you.